Sure, thank you so much. Great to be here. Nice to meet all of you. I will show you some pictures and will tell you hopefully some interesting stories about that. So when people think about artists, probably they also think about photographers. I wouldn't consider myself much an artist. I'm a documentary photographer. Perhaps you know Robert Capa, who was one of the big documentary photographers in the world, and he's one of my heroes. So he said that if your pictures aren't good enough, you're not close enough. And for over 10 years, I was photographing in violent demonstrations. That's the 1st of May in Berlin, for example. The same. So whenever like the situation gets really crowded and really stressful, like my mind gets even calmer. I don't know if you know that, driving pretty quickly on the autobahn and thinking, oh, if I don't concentrate enough, it could end in a bad way. That's how I feel when I photograph demonstrations. That was, for example, hooligans at the German, like the World Cup in Germany. I was following hooligans around Germany. This was the G8 in Rostock, which was kind of stressful because normally in a demonstration, in my opinion, it's quite easy. You have the police, you have the protesters, and there's only one direction of stones or whatever. But here in Rostock, you had like many directions of stones. So they were shooting stones from there. So I think that was one of the only demonstrations ever in my life where I went out of the situation to stay safe. This is one of my favorite pictures, definitely here at the G8 in Rostock. It felt like Robocop movie or whatever. It was directly in the middle of nowhere. And people were blocking and demonstrating the situation or the scenery there, and then a lot of helicopters came in. That felt really special, as you can imagine. So this was at the inauguration of Trump. When he was inaugurated in Washington, a lot of people didn't like that, me included. So they were putting a limousine in fire. And it was really stressful for me as well, because police in Germany, generally, they have a limited amount of pressure they could put on you. They have the sticks, then they can kick you or they can box you. But in America, they have shock grenades. So this was a shock grenade going off like 3 or 5 meters in front of me. And I was like really in shock and I was giggling and that was really funny. Yeah, nothing happened, but it was still, it was really interesting. And sometimes you could say I'm too close. I was documenting neo-Nazis in Germany for many years until they knew who I was and told me to go the fuck off. So when these guys, it's not obvious in this picture, but his arms were like probably as big as my. He was frightening the shit out of me. So whenever you read something in newspapers about neo-Nazi terrorists, it's pretty up now. The percentage is pretty high that I got them on a picture. But what I wanted to show you, that was a small view about my work, is I was on a tour with a death metal band, with a German death metal band this summer. And the funny thing is I don't even really like death metal. I don't really get it, but it's really awesome. And it's especially awesome to have a girlfriend who is into photography as well. That's how you get these pictures. That's me here, shooting in the metal days in Slovenia. So right side, that's my friend Marco. And Marco is the guitarist of guitar player of this death metal band called Critical Mass. And when he was posting to Facebook that he was going to release a new album this year and was going to go to Wacken, like my spider sensors went off. Like, I have someone who's going to Wacken and I can invite myself as a photographer. So I was writing a message to him and asked him like, hey Marco, can I come as a photographer? And so, yeah, I landed in Wacken this year. So I was trying to document the whole process of the album. So I was meeting them at the recording sessions. That's Rita. Yeah, and she sounds like she's looking right now. Which is really interesting because normally people, when they hear the music, perhaps we can have some music in 2 minutes, then people think, oh, that's a man for sure. But when they see it's a young lady, it's really, really knocks the socks off some people. So this is Benny, the drummer, and his girlfriend, she's into making dolls. So this is not a voodoo doll, but like a mini Benny doll. So when you're following a band, what I think is really interesting to see or to make the pictures that are not really obvious. That's something you probably would never see if you couldn't be there with them. That's Britta, Loma, Marco, Britta again. Yeah, they were playing small festivals this year and also big ones. That's something which is really important for the fans of them. And even these situations where someone comes up and says, well, you helped me through a really dark time in my life, obviously. And we were also in some really small clubs where you can smell the smell of sweat, see the sweat like dropping down from there. And always these pictures like on stage, off stage. There was a disco afterwards that was a really funny situation because these young ladies, they didn't know where they like went to. That was the release party of their album, and they were like, ooh, is this the place we wanted to go to? He played just 2 sets as a drummer for 2 bands. And Benny was really proud to have a selfie with this guy. He's the drummer of some other band, which I obviously don't know, but yeah, he's a big fan of him as well. Loma slightly drunk in front of the main stage here. And there we are backstage. Imagine coming to a festival where you have the backstage like 2 hours before your gig and like 3 hours after that gig, but you're allowed to keep everything which is in the fridge. So just imagine our like bags full of beer and Coke and whatever after that. I think Dimmu Borgir had like the backstage right next to us. Mark was seeing for the first time the biggest stage he ever saw in his life. Metal Days was a huge stage. That's definitely one of my favorite pictures. Don't you think she looks like an angel? Thank you. So this is one. They invited me to stay in a tent for many days, but I happily declined. I just went for one day. I took the train to this button. It's not even a city, it's a village. Has anyone been to Wacken before? Okay, did you hear about Wacken?
Yes.
It's a huge festival. I think 75 or 80,000 people coming to a really small town in northern Germany. And it was the first time for me. It was really interesting. So these people there, obviously pretty drunk. It was loud. This was the loudest music machine I ever had. It's like 10 times of this here. It was so loud. And the people living there. And it's a happy and friendly coexistence, because Wacken pays all the bills of the village. So when people come there and leave a lot of money there, that's how they build the official pool, that's how they build the schools and everything. So it's totally okay for them. But not everything. A lot of green gardens are with these here. And some even bring, what's the English name? Ducks. Yeah, like this thing. Then as you can see, it looks a bit more professional. Many, many more people looking for the professional stage. And I have to say that it was the most magic situation I ever had. I was photographing concerts for many, many years, but being in Wacken was really special. 10 minutes before the gig, this place here was empty. No one was there. We were thinking, is someone coming to us? Is this going to be full? Because right when they were playing, the Offspring was playing on another stage, so even others. This was another really funny thing. Backstage there were like big signs that, like the Wall of Death, which is this, is forbidden. So they were saying, if you announce the Wall of Death as a band, you're kicked out immediately. So, and we were making fun backstage. So who knows what the Wall of Death is? Okay, so for all the others, the procedure goes as follows. The audience splits in half, and then the band plays, and generally people like say no, but here it wasn't allowed, so they did it themselves. And then they run towards each other, and depending on the place, like the places I regularly go to, like hardcore concerts, you kick like the other people. Here they were just running, but still. So in backstage they met the singer of Diamond Head, which is a really old band, and like Metallica is covering them every time when they play. And this led to this really interesting situation. We went to the stage and we were next stage, side stage, and that's what we could see there. That was a really magical moment for me.
Sorry for interrupting.
No worries.
The speaker must be here.
Oh. So where should the speaker be?
It should be here, but for the training, please take one.
Okay. So he's doing a party right now.
I think he's doing it like a bit of a marketing like a scenario, right? Beat 81 is over there. If you're in the wrong room, right?
So should he ever be in Wacken, definitely send me a picture or two. And if you always wanted to go to Wacken, you should definitely mark your calendars right now because the next button was sold out in like, I think, 1 hour. It was really crazy. So this was definitely one of the best like on stage pictures I ever had. We didn't see the wheelchair guy when we were taking the picture, but afterwards it was like, holy moly, like what happened there? So yeah, glad to be here. Thank you for.
We wanted to ask the people who are attending, does anybody have a question directly now for Ralph? It's very silent. But isn't Wacken the biggest rock festival in Europe? Because that's what I know it as.
I think it is. I think from stage-wise, they have like 12 stages and
it's more,
like
yeah.
300 bands or something like that. I don't know if it's like about the attendance of 80,000 people. Yeah, but
legendary.
It's huge.
Is it Jägermeister the biggest sponsor for them? I always remember the logo. Okay. Does anybody have a question for Ralph? Or? Okay.
But I don't think I need a microphone.
Oh, you do.
You do.
Okay. I feel like a metal singer now. There is Etha playing with Union Berlin very soon for the first time since the two teams are in the first league, and that's a very high risk game. Are you going to be there?
Now that you are mentioning it, I probably have to mark my calendar, yes.
Yeah, you should.
Yeah, but football isn't interesting me like anymore too much, but I will definitely mark that in my calendar when you want to hear that.
Cool, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, we got one here.
Yeah, just as a photographer, how did you decide to switch from such a political subject as neo-Nazis to capturing something like this?
It's a really good question. I think the main part of my work, I will show later on, I will show pictures of a refugee family I was following for a year. My main work is about opportunity. So when I see topics where I can dive in and be in the center of action, that's something that interests me. And it's not so much about the topics itself, but it's more about the opportunity to be close and to learn something new and to be somewhere which is really interesting. And yeah, that was really interesting.
When you do political documentary, like, do you try to be objective? Do you try to be objective or do you take a side, or what's your opinion on that?
Sometimes there are questions they are afraid of. That's one of the questions.
Yeah.
It's a good question. Probably it's pretty hard to be objective working with neo-Nazis. I hope you are my opinion. It's definitely that, like, my view on police and view on police in demonstration situations changed. Like, I see a lot of violence there. I see a lot of violence that is not necessary, in my opinion. And this is something which definitely changed, but I always keep to at least have a minimum objectivity, to say it like that. Yeah, but I'm leftish, kind of, yeah, hope that kind of answers your question.
The roundup for that. Thank you, Ralph.